Oasis Audio presents Father Fiction by Donald Miller, read for you by Kelly Ryan Dolan.
For Oasis Audio, I'm Wayne Shepherd. A number of years ago, I was filling in on a radio talk show when a mostly unknown guest named Donald Miller showed up on the roster as the author of Prayer and the Art of Volkswagen Maintenance. Well, I remember virtually nothing about the interview except that Don Miller was a young author who seemed to be raising questions and exploring issues of faith like no one else was at that time. Well, a few years later, and a few books and a couple of bestsellers later, he's once again joining me in conversation. We're both older and hopefully somewhat wiser. Don, I'm glad we have this chance to catch up today.
Yeah, it's very good to be back with you.
Do you remember that interview so long ago?
I remember it very, very well. I think you were surprised that I remember, but you know, you do a lot of interviews and most people haven't read the book and have no idea who you are. But I think you actually prepared for the interview, which makes you stand out.
I was probably so intimidated about talking to Don Miller that I thought I better prepare.
No, remember, I was a nobody. I was a little kid in a t-shirt.
Well, this new book, on the heels of so many very successful books, Blue Like Jazz, Searching for God Knows What, A Million Miles in a Thousand Years, what great books. But this new book is a little different for you in some ways, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It's a memoir about growing up without a father, and it's really written, even though it's a memoir voice, it's not a true memoir in the sense that I did have an audience in mind. I had young people growing up without dads or adults who had grown up without a father in the home or an absentee father, and was really trying to just find as much common ground as I could with those people. And so this book explores that issue and hopefully provides a lot of hope.
As I began reading Father Fiction, I kept looking for you to disclose about your own dad. And there's little bits along the way, but it all comes out, doesn't it, in the chapter on forgiveness?
Yes. Yes. My dad left when I was a little kid. And so I didn't see him until I was 35, maybe. And so from 2 or 3 till 35, I virtually had no contact with him. In fact, for the last 20 years, we didn't even know if he was dead or alive. And so I had to ask myself, have I forgiven my father for abandoning the family? And I have this pastor here in Portland named Rick McKinley, and Rick defined forgiveness as carrying the burden that somebody gives you without holding them responsible.
Yeah, I underlined that in my copy. That was powerful.
I thought so, too. And it certainly gave me a freedom to forgive him, because I think before I thought, you know, to forgive somebody, you kind of have to be over it, or you have to be healed, or it can't bother you anymore. You know, that's what forgiveness is. But that's really not the case. Forgiveness is just, I will not hold this person responsible in any way, not even in a manipulative, hey, I'm a victim. And so with growing up without a father, and there's been so much healing in my life that God has done amazing things despite that, and so I have no reason to complain. But I just don't have any bitterness or anger against him anymore. And he needed that. My father really needed that in order to move on and to find peace. And, of course, that's a very powerful thing in somebody's life when you forgive them. And you do so without even them asking for forgiveness. I had the luxury of my father actually asked me if I would forgive him, and I was able to say yes. But probably a lot of people never get that luxury.
That's right.
But you can still forgive. You can forgive even if they're gone, even if they passed away. You can say, you know what? I'm not holding you responsible for what I'm having to deal with. And it heals them if they're alive and they know what you're doing, and it heals you too.
Yeah. Don, all of your books are about you in a way, but in a way they're not. I mean, they sort of capture what we all feel and experience. And who is this book for, Father Fiction?
It's for people who grew up without dads. I mean, it's for the neglectful dads, the ones who emotionally weren't there for them, and it explores that chasm, which is an enormous issue. I think it's the dominant issue in our culture. There are about 27 million kids growing up without fathers. 85% of men in prison grew up without fathers. So let's say that that fathers stuck around. You would have 85% less people in prison, presumably. You would turn back divorce rates enormously. You would curb teen suicide, teen dropout rates, teen drug use, unwanted pregnancy, and as a product of that, you would curb the abortion rate, all if dads stuck around. And so that means that there's a lot of emotional stuff that happens when your father isn't there.
Right.
When, for me, Wayne, it was a story of suspended adolescence. Going into my 20s, even my late 20s, with issues wondering whether I was a man, you know, wondering whether I had what it took to get the job done.
Or what did that even look like, right?
Well, I mean, in all areas of life, I mean, I was successful. You know, even in my 20s, I was the president of a publishing company, so I certainly had loads of ambition. But there wasn't a maturity to go along with that ambition. I was still wanting, you know, people to affirm me. And there was also a real bitterness and an anger against men in my life who were older and had any sort of authority. Now, I wasn't anti-authority. I didn't have that. But occasionally when somebody told me to do something and this person really didn't care about me, they didn't have a relationship with me that was loving and kind and affirming, but they were telling me what to do, I just couldn't take it. I mean, I would get so angry. And it was in writing this book that I began to discover, oh, these are absent father issues that you're dealing with. Hmm. It's really funny because when I started writing the book, you know, you're going to laugh, but I assumed I had what it took to write this book because I had made it. You know, all these kids had grown up with their dads, and they were going to prison. They were getting in trouble. They had children that with women they weren't married to. All these kinds of things, and I didn't have any of that. And I thought, you know, I should write a book and tell these kids how to get through that tough thing. So I started just, you know, researching the issue, and I find out, oh my gosh, I'm screwed up.
Well,
I have a lot of healing to do in my own life.
Doesn't that always happen? I mean, I'm not a writer, but when you write a book, I suspect that it humbles you in many ways.
Oh, it's the most humbling process. It's the most humbling process. Yeah, it's it's daily sitting down in front of the blank page and having the blank page make fun of you.
It mocks you, doesn't it?
It mocks you. It mocks you every day. Yeah, you come away. See, the writing of the book humbles you, and the book tour makes you arrogant. So that's how it works.
That's the yin and the yang of
exactly.
Of writing, huh? Okay.
Michael.
Well, in the book, there are several people who step up in the absence of your father. One was John McMurray, and you go into detail about that. I don't want to go into all the detail because people are going to listen to or read your book, but just a word about John and his influence in your life.
Well, John is one of the most influential guys that I've known. There's been three. I mean, there's been a lot of mentors, but there are three guys who were enormous influence. And John was the middle guy. He's the guy I lived with in my early 20s. He taught a Bible study at a church out in the suburb of Portland, Oregon, and I lived in his house and went to the Bible study. And it was the first time I'd ever lived with a family, a functional, you know, husband and wife with kids, family. And so it was shocking to see how the system was supposed to work. It seemed very strange to me at first. And then the longer I lived there, the more I appreciated John. And he also just really loved me. I mean, he really cared about me. And John is not a sappy, emotional, I want to hug you guy, although he's gotten that way as he's gotten older. But he's a tough guy. You know, he's out of Philadelphia. He speaks his mind. He's sarcastic and somewhat cynical, and he would kind of whip me into place sometimes. But he believed in me. In fact, when I started a publishing company, he invested in the company and put a lot of his family's savings into that company, which basically broke even and paid him back a little bit, and that's it, you know. But we did the whole thing on a handshake deal and never signed contracts or anything like that. I mean, he just really trusted me. And so he was a huge influence. And so when I went to write this book, I asked John, would you write it with me? And essentially what I did was I wrote each chapter, and I sent it to John, and he would call and say, you know, I think this, and that. But there was so much editorial work done by him in the book, and because I used his life so much, actually, when the book first came out, it was a co-written book, and for sales purposes, the publishing company wanted to take John's name off the cover, but essentially, he's all through that book.
You see John on the cover all the time, don't you?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, it goes beyond just a book for you because you have something called the Mentoring Project. I'm fascinated by this. I want to hear all about this Mentoring Project.
Well, I could talk about it for days, so you're going to have to shut me up. I'm actually at the Mentoring Project office right now. When I was writing the book, I realized that there was a guy named David Gentiles who stepped into my life when I was right in junior high. And I was breaking into houses and stealing money off of people's dressers, you know, and shooting guns inside of a guy's house that I'd broken into. And David came along and invited me to this book study. We studied the singer, the song, and the finale. And it was my introduction to literature. And then he asked me to write a column for the youth group newsletter, and I wrote that column. And it didn't take very long. I was really interested in writing, and I was no longer interested in breaking into houses. And my whole friendship group changed when David kind of took me under his wing. So he saved my life. That guy, one guy, just by befriending me. He didn't even spend a lot of time with me. He just befriended me, and a couple times a week we would hang out. And that was really remarkable. So when I was writing this book, I thought, man, you know, these kids need more than a book. They need a positive male role model. I'm specifically talking about guys. Positive male role model is desperately needed in order to change a life. And it's just going and shooting hoops once a week with somebody. So I thought, well, you know, we've got 27 million kids growing up without dads, and we have 360,000 churches in America. And men are sitting around in these churches looking for something to do, you know, looking for a project, looking for
something meaningful.
It's something very meaningful. And so I thought, well, what if we recruit mentors for these churches so each church could have their own little mentoring program? We could mentor the fatherless boys in America in the space of about 20 years. And if you provide a positive male role model to a child, he's much less likely to get into trouble, use drugs, drop out of school, end up in prison, these kinds of things. So we could actually shut down a significant number of American prisons 20 years from now if the church stepped up and mentored these kids. So we started an organization. We recruit and train mentors in a pretty intense program, and then partner them with a mentor through the Big Brothers Big Sisters organization, because we didn't want to reinvent the wheel. And so our goal here in Portland, there's a 1,000-person waiting list for young boys growing up without dads. And the reason we only deal with young boys is because most mentoring programs have an enormous number of white women volunteering. I mean, an enormous number, a very small percentage of men volunteered to mentor. So we said, you know what, we're going to focus on the men, and we're going to get these young boys who are much more likely to get into trouble than young girls a positive male role model. So that's the reason we focus on boys. So we're mentoring 150 or so kids right now in Portland. We have a 1,000 mentor goal by the end of the year. That will take Big Brothers and Big Sisters waiting list and make it zero. There will be, if you are a young boy in Portland, you're the 1,000th person in line waiting for a mentor. And we want to make that list go down to zero. And then we're looking at Tyler, Texas. We're looking at Atlanta, Georgia. We're looking at Los Angeles, California, Seattle, Washington. And we're getting numbers on their waiting lists. And we're going to go into those cities and make those waiting lists.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.